Cool.
Wow. So this isn't our first rodeo, but it still takes a full team. And Gen Z and Mel, like, oh goodness, like, that's a position that y'all have.
Okay, Chris, remember to mute yourself at 5.
Ready, set, I can do it right now.
Okay.
All right, do you want me to start webinar?
We can wait till right at 5. Oh, yes.
Okay, are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, starting in 3, 2, 1.
Virgen de regla, hoy es tu día, madre de agua, diosa mía.
Okay, welcome everyone to this evening's Plastic Justice event with the distinguished Kristal Ocean Ambrose. We're really excited to host a nuanced conversation around plastic with you all, one that's not just about plastic, but about the system that enables it. We're excited to talk with Kristal about how this pervasive culture of convenience has uneven impacts racially, transnationally, ecologically even. And we're really excited to discuss what we can do and what we need to do about it.
Before we begin, we'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the indigenous peoples upon whose land UC Santa Cruz was built on and continues to occupy. Because this is a historic and contemporary reality of indigenous dispossession, and it's inseparable from our current conversation around the environmental and social crises that we witness. So as Ms. T's plastic scholar and Professor Max LeBron states, pollution is a function of colonialism. So UC Santa Cruz is located on the unceded territory of the Awaswa-speaking tribe, the Awamamutsin tribal band comprised of the descendants of the indigenous people taken to Mission Santa Cruz and San Juan Bautista during Spanish colonization of the Central Coast. It's a day working hard to restore traditional stewardship practices on these lands and heal from historical trauma.
Thank you, Bree, for that important pause and reminder. This event is a collaborative effort within the ethnic resource centers on campus, in particular the African American Resource and Cultural Center, also known as the ARC, and the People of Color Sustainability Collective, or POCSC. My name is Chris Lang, and I'm a fourth year doctoral student in environmental studies, as well as the graduate student intern for the People of Color Sustainability Collective. In my research, I think about community health and infrastructure that can allow for collective divestment from toxic and extractive modes of living and investment into circular, regenerative, ethical, and equitable ways of living.
And my name is Breanna Byrd, and I'm a second year graduate student in the Department of Feminist Studies, and I'm also the graduate intern for the ARC. And I think about race, sustainability, and narratives of world ending and world making. And I really center the ways that Black and Brown folks who've been disenfranchised, who are often discounted from the conversations of environmental justice, are really at the forefront of the solutions. And so I'm really excited to have Kristal here today to think about that and share some of that with you all. And a little bit about another one of our sponsors today. We're also here representing the Black Geographies Lab, which is an ongoing work thinking collaboratively about diaspora, place, race, and space making practices. And then in addition, the African American Resource and Cultural Center seeks to cultivate supportive and safe communities for African, Black, and Caribbean identifying students here on campus. And as the oldest of the resource centers, and one created through the efforts of student protests, we work to meet the holistic needs of ABC students at the UCSC campus.
And POCSC, which currently resides within the American Indian Resource Center, aims to diversify and politicize conversations around sustainability on campus and community, and in community more broadly, highlighting the essential contributions that people of color have historically and continue to make for environmental and social well-being. We create content, implement programming, conduct research on campus to push the limits of environmental discourse and assess the student pulse of relationships between equity and ecology. We'd also like to acknowledge all of the staff and student interns who support these efforts in front of and behind the screen that you see today.
So with these two resource centers in mind, it's no surprise that we're ecstatic to have Kristal Ocean Ambrose here with us this evening. In fact, even though it's evening time for us, it's 2 o'clock in the morning where Kristal is calling in from right now from the World Maritime University in Sweden. So Kristal Ambrose is a rising star as far as we know, but has been doing this work for a very long time. And she is a 2020 Goldman Environmental Prize recipient for Waste Solutions, an environmental scientist, a youth catalyst, and a necessary change maker in the world. In 2015, Kristal founded the Bahamas Plastic Movement to raise community awareness on the unrelenting issue of plastic in Bahamian waters, beaches, and lands. Implementing annual plastic camps with youth from all over the archipelago, Kristal sought to politicize the energy of youth and young people from every day in order to change a national policy. A testament to their success, the Bahamas Ministry of Environment and Housing created a task force to advance the phasing out of single-use plastics by 2020, which is now in place. Using citizen science, education, arts, and research, the Bahamas Plastic Movement has cultivated a generation of young people who are activated community leaders for ecological and social well-being. These are the plastic warriors. So please enjoy this short film screening before we have Kristal introduce herself.
The marine litter concentrations for the Bahamas and the wider Caribbean are almost 3 times the global average. And in 2025, the projected plastic pollution accumulation for the Bahamas is expected to increase to some 687 million metric tons. And this is in the place that I call home. The place where the amount of plastic pollution invading our shorelines actually displaces the biomass of the people who live here. And this is paradise. You know, this is where I'm from. This is a vacationer's dream. But when you peel back the veils of this idyllic space, you begin to see that paradise is actually polluted by plastic. And in often cases, it's plastic that doesn't even belong to us. My name is Kristal Ambrose, also known as Kristal Ocean, and I'm a self-proclaimed plastic warrior. Ever since I was a little girl, I've had this love affair with the ocean. You know, I remember being so little, riding on a Sunday in my father's truck and seeing the horizon of the ocean and just being mesmerized and so curious and astonished by this deep blue. The one person in my family who had the strongest relationship to the ocean was my father. He taught us to swim, but in the most unconventional way. He didn't give us the skill and the technique, but he tossed us into the deep end. And we had to fend for ourselves, sink or swim, but we always knew that he was always one swim away. And when I reflect on my life and my time with my father and his connection to the ocean, I realize that he was preparing me for something bigger. I see that he was preparing me for the biggest fight of my life. And that fight being the fight for the thing that I love the most, the ocean, and protecting it against plastic pollution. Never set out to save the Bahamas from plastic or from waste or anything like that, but for the life of me, I kept having these visions and these manifestations of the whole country moving with me to move towards this Bahamas that was free of plastic debris. And it was in that moment that Bahamas Plastic Movement was born. And we're the grassiest grassroots organization you can think of. We're totally community and youth-based. People that are connected to the ocean, connected to the environment, and committed to making a difference. Through research, education, citizen science, and policy change all around plastic pollution, those are the things that we focus on to help develop solutions to this crisis in our own country. And even though we're so focused on plastic pollution, our organization is really rooted in the hopefulness of engaging youth and young people in education and activism around plastic pollution. Core component of our organization is our Plastic Pollution Education and Ocean Conservation Summer Camp, also known as the Plastic Camp. And during this time, we have students that come from around the Bahamas to learn all about the issue. And for me, working with youth is so important because they're the next generation, right? You start there, they're the ones that are molding their own futures. They're the ones that deserve a seat at the table and making decisions that impact their future. You know, youth, they're strong, powerful, and effective leaders. When they speak, the world listens. And I personally believe that youth are the change. So in our program, our students, they come in, they learn all about the issue through hands-on connections with scientific research. You know, they're out on the boat trawling for microplastics in the ocean. They're dissecting the stomachs of fish like mahi-mahi or birds like albatross to see if they're actually ingesting plastic. And it's in this moment where they make the connection between how their lifestyle on land actually impacts animals and animals that they like to eat. They're doing the art and the activism around this issue. They're pushing policy and having their voices heard and realizing that they have the power to affect change. And that's what it's about. It's connecting students to the ocean so that they are empowered to make a difference within their own lives, their own schools, homes, communities, and most importantly, in our country, where we're surrounded by water, where we're surrounded by so much plastic that's invading our shores. They are the ones that are gonna be at the front lines making a difference. They are the plastic warriors.
Kristal has so much amazing energy, and I think that she gets that from growing up here in the Bahamas, and that makes the show run. She brings all of her energy and good vibes and her amazing work with kids, and she gets everyone so excited about what they're doing and really connects them in a way that we couldn't do ourselves, and so we love learning from her and having her there.
The first time I saw Kristal, I felt off her energy, and I feel like it's so inspiring how even when times may be rough for her, she still gives us energy and positivity to make sure that we feel great and that we feel confident and that we have a better learning experience.
Being an alumni of Bahamas Plastic Movement and working with Ms. Kristal has changed how I view how plastic affects the environment and has made me more self-conscious when I'm using certain products. It has deepened my passion for the ocean and the marine life that lives inside, and it has also made me more outspoken when spreading awareness.
If I was to describe Kristal in one word, I would say bright, because she just brings light to every situation, and she's just so inspiring and makes everybody happy.
Kristal brings a unique joy to her work, and she has a unique passion for empowering young people and people of color to enter the conversation about environmental conservation. And that's something that nobody had really focused on up to now. She's from this little country, this tiny country of islands that people know only for sun, sand, and sea. And yet she is playing a leading role in one of the most complex global environmental issues. She is leading policy and activism, and actually, you know, in the Bahamas, innovating a way forward to expand a conversation about combating pollution is revolutionary. And the biggest part about it, because of the youth work being challenging and the environmental work being challenging, Kristal brings joy. She brings joy to the work, and that is magic.
My favorite thing about here is the connection to the sea, right? You look outside and you see kids swimming in the ocean, and it's such a beautiful thing. And at this beach, you look and you see it looks clean. But when you take a closer look at other beaches that surround this beautiful island, you'll see that our paradise is actually polluted, you know, and often by plastic that washes in from a foreign source. I can't stand the thought of a child from another generation of anyone not experiencing the ocean for years to come. And that's what drives me to continue this work. The connection my father has to the ocean, the connection of my country to the ocean, I am viscerally tied to the ocean, and that visceral feeling is what inspires me and keeps me going in my fight to protect it.
Just incredible. I mean, incredible. And I'm here for all of this, Kristal. And I know we've kept you long enough from introducing yourself and sharing your amazing work and research. So please, please, everyone, let's welcome Kristal. And yeah, take it away.
Thank you so much. Let me just share my screen here. All right, can you guys see my screen? All right, thank you so much, everyone, for being here. Every time I see Plastic Warriors, it gets me grounded again, you know, and I'm just filled with so much gratitude that I've been selected and ordained to do this work, and that I get to share on this platform our approach to solutions to plastic pollution using youth. Before I begin, I would like to acknowledge Breanna, Byrd, and Chris Lang, who have organized this whole event in conjunction with the People of Color Sustainability Collective, University of California, Santa Cruz, the ARC, I don't have to say AARCC, the ARC. I'm just really grateful to be here, so thank you so much. My name is Kristal Ambrose, also known as Kristal Ocean, and I'm the founder and director of the Bahamas Plastic Movement, and I am calling you from Sweden. It is after 2 a.m, and this is the most productive I've been at this kind of time in a long time. You know, usually I'm aimlessly scrolling on social media, but I'm so happy that I get to be here and be connected with all of you. So thank you so much to everyone for taking the time to be here today. So we're going to talk about plastic. Not too much, because I don't like to focus so much on plastic, but I like to focus on the solutions. But we know that plastic is everywhere, right? It's a gift and the curse. And the exact same things that make plastic such a great product, its durability, its convenience, is also the exact same thing that makes it a detriment to the environment. Right now, by 2050, the production level of plastic is set to soar to some 34 billion metric tons produced. And that also coincides with the fact that by 2050, there's said to be more plastic in the ocean than fish by weight, right? And when we look at where this plastic goes, it all goes downstream. More than 91% of all plastic ever produced has never been recycled. It either ends up in the environment or ends up in landfills. And more often than not, it ends up invading the shorelines of small island developing states like the Bahamas, where I call home. And even watching that documentary just now, I'm like, man, I can't wait to get back to the ocean. But for geographic context, for those of you that aren't familiar with the Bahamas, we are an archipelagic nation in the Atlantic Ocean. We're a part of the wider Caribbean region, and we compose of over 700 islands and keys and more than 2,000 rocks. I'm from New Providence, which is this little island here. But I spend most of my time on the island of Eleuthera, the island of freedom, and that's where I feel most at home. And you can see, you know, the Bahamas is really vast and it's beautiful. It's a touristic paradise. And this is the expectation, right? Sun, sand, and sea, pink sand, beaches, turquoise waters. And though this is true, when we peel back the veils of this touristic space, we begin to see that our paradise is polluted by plastic. And quite often it's plastic that doesn't even belong to us, plastic that didn't necessarily generate on our shorelines, but it ends up there. But that's not to say that Bahamians are exempt from the woes of pollution, because within the urban setting of the Bahamas especially, there's still a lot of illegal dumping that happens. This is in a community in Nassau, Bahamas, which is the capital. And when we think about how our waste is managed, it all goes either into the environment or to the central location, being the dump. You know, that's what we call our landfill. And on New Providence, which is the capital of the Bahamas, the landfill occupies 100 acres of land. And this landfill is synonymous with random explosions, right? So it randomly combusts, the methane builds up, and you have these fires, and the dump is right near communities. And this is where my family lives in Nassau, actually. So whenever the dump is on fire, we have to close our windows. Everything around us smells just toxic. And there's been so many instances of respiratory illnesses that neighboring communities has faced as a result of the dump constantly being on fire. So in this small island setting, everything is single stream. It goes from use directly to the landfill where it's burned. Now, just as an update, within the last 2 years or so in New Providence, they have reclaimed the landfill. It's now called the New Providence Ecology Center or the Ecology Park. And they're recycling, they're composting, they have a green waste facility. So I'm really excited to dive deeper into what that looks like and how that's gonna perpetuate better waste management in the Bahamas. Because the reality is everything is centric to Nassau, which is the city. But when you go to small island communities like the island of Eleuthera, where I'm based, this is what our landfills look like. And you have these in every community. So Eleuthera is 200 miles long, and it has over 20 settlements or little towns. So you can imagine 20 different dumps, which are poorly engineered. There's no lining to protect any leachate that goes to the groundwater source, which people rely on. In addition to that, this open pit burning of this mixed material, again, releases toxic fumes that goes into neighboring communities. And subsequently on the island of Eleuthera, they have the highest breast cancer rates in the Bahamas. I'm not saying that there's a correlation, but it's definitely something that should be explored. But not only are we faced with the debris that's washing onto our shorelines from a foreign source, debris that comes at the hands of the tourism industry, where we see upwards of 5 million people coming to our country every year, compared to a population of 400,000 people. That's a lot of waste that's left behind. But on top of that, we now have to deal with the new realities of climate disaster debris. And I just want to take a moment to acknowledge all of those that were impacted by Hurricane Dorian in 2019. It was the strongest storm on record to ever hit the Bahamas. And in its wake, not only did it take lives, unfortunately, but it also left behind somewhat of 1.5 billion pounds of debris. And as climate change continues to intensify, this is going to become the new normal. So now we have to consider, how are we managing the waste that we produce, the waste that washes ashore, and the waste that is left behind due to natural disasters. Now, I never set out to study marine debris or plastic pollution. My background is in the field of marine science, and that's all I wanted to do, you know, just dive and count the fish underwater and call it a day. So 7-8 years ago, I got the opportunity of a lifetime, 9 years ago now, I got the opportunity of a lifetime to sail across the Pacific Ocean to study the Western Garbage Patch. And I did this with the Five Gyres organization. And the Western Garbage Patch, it's a part of the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, or also known as the Great Pacific Gyre. And gyres are just huge circulating currents that trap marine debris. And this particular garbage patch that we went to, it hadn't been surveyed in nearly a quarter of a century. And this was also a year after the Fukushima disaster in Japan. So we wanted to see how fast debris was getting into that gyre or into that garbage patch. So we sailed from the Marshall Islands all the way to Japan. And we were on board this boat, the Sea Dragon, for about 20 days. You can see the crew. It's pretty diverse. I don't know if you can find me in that picture. but for 20 days, we lived on this boat, and there was no wildlife, or there was no islands in the distance. There were no airplanes flying over. There were no boats passing us by. It was just us, wildlife, and waste. And we came upon this netball, as you can see in this photo here. And a netball is just this huge conglomerate of discarded fishing gear, like ropes and nets and buoys, that kind of magnetizes with other types of plastic debris. So we come across this netball in 16,000 feet of water, and underneath that, it was its own ecosystem. There were fish swimming under it. There were fish that were caught up in the net that were dead. There were different organisms like anemones and coastal crabs that you don't find in the deep water that had found its way into this net and made it its home. We dissected this netball and discovered 20 different types of rope, different types of plastic fragments and bottles and toys and all kinds of things. And, you know, my initial reaction was like, humans are so nasty. Why are they polluting the ocean? And then as I started to sift through everything we were dissecting, I was like, oh, I have a toothbrush just like this in my backpack. Okay, I have some forks like this in my cupboard at home. You know, so I started to realize that everything we were finding were things that I was using in my daily life. And in that moment, I realized I was a huge part of the problem. And equally so, I could be a part of the solution. So once this trip wrapped up, I was on the flight heading back home. And I was like, man, by the end of the week, the whole Bahamas is going to be plastic free. That was 9 years ago. So just to illustrate, it didn't happen that easily. But what did happen was the spark in the production of the Bahamas plastic movement, which is very near and dear to my heart. It's my baby. But Bahamas Plastic Movement, we're an environmental nonprofit organization geared towards raising awareness and finding solutions to plastic pollution. And we do this through the four pillars of research, education, citizen science, and policy change. And Bahamas Plastic Movement, I always tell people, We're the grassiest grassroots organization you can come across. It's a backpack organization, which means it goes wherever I go. So right now our current address is in Sweden. When I get back home to the Bahamas, we'll be rooted back in the Bahamas. We have no overhead, we have no staff, we have no constant barrage of activities. We're all about slow growth and high impact with a community focus and the work that is heart driven. So our pillars, we look at research, how is plastic moving over space and over time? What are the concentrations, the composition, the sources of debris that's washing ashore in the country? Education, how do we share this message with youth and community? Citizen science, how do we bridge that gap between community and science and get the average person onto the beach with us to quantify the amount of plastic that's out there? And policy change, how do we use the aforementioned pillars to then drive policy? And the citizen science research is actually how Bahamas Plastic Movement started. It started through this project called the Plastic Beach Project that I started with a colleague of mine and dear friend, Carolyn Box from Five Gyres. And basically we were looking at how plastic was moving over space and over time on beaches in South Eleuthera, Bahamas. So I would take students to the beach with me and I would have them help me collect data. And while we're on the beach, I would always say jokingly and unawarely, I'd be like, this is the Bahamas Plastic Movement, you know, and I would just say it. And it wasn't until like a year later, I was like, I'm gonna start a nonprofit. And that was the name, because I just kept having this vision and manifestation of a nation moving with me to create a nation free of plastic debris. So through the Citizen Science Project, we were able to collect data on debris loads at different exposures. So if a beach was exposed to the Atlantic Ocean or the Bahama banks, which were really shallow, or the Exuma Sound, which is really deep. And what we found was that plastic was the dominant debris type across all exposures. And more than 50 or 60% of the plastic we collected actually came in from a foreign source, and it represented 93% of all debris types collected. But not only are we doing the science, we're also focusing on environmental education. Because even though we focus so much on plastic, our organization is truly rooted in the hopefulness of engaging young people in environmental education, activism, and stewardship, and helping them to understand that their voices are important. So youth are a key role in everything that we do in this organization. They're really the foundation of our work. In addition to this, we also do a ton of beach cleanups. And June is like summer camp season, hashtag summer camp SZN. And we kick it off with our beach cleanups, right? Whenever I get home following the school semester, hit the ground running with our World Oceans Day beach cleanup. To date, we've had over 1,000 volunteers remove more than 5,000 pounds of debris from 8 different Bahamian islands, from beaches on 8 different islands. And our beach cleanups are really fun. I'll show you better than I can tell you.
So today is a beautiful day. We are here to celebrate our beautiful ocean. Everyone look behind you and say, thank you, ocean.
Thank you, ocean.
Beaches is plastic with bite marks in it, and you see these are triangular bite marks that usually come from triggerfish, for example, and it's a substance that they can't digest.
So you get an idea. We go and we do these cleanups, and it's really a monumental effort. The sun is hot, you're wrangling students, there's so much debris, it can be overwhelming. And then the ocean just sends you this omen in the form of its creatures to say thank you. And for me personally, that's just a reminder that we're doing the right thing and this work is important. Now, our beach cleanups, they are a precursor to the main event of summer for Bahamas Plastic Movement, and that main event being our Plastic Pollution Education and Ocean Conservation Summer Camp, or Plastic Camp for short, because that's a really long name. But Plastic Camp, it's a tuition-free program where students, they go on this holistic journey where they learn about the problem with plastic to finding solutions to this environmental crisis. And they're placed at the center of being the solutions and developing the solutions forward. So over the course of 5 to 7 days, our students are engaged in scientific research, education and advocacy. They're doing policy work, they're doing art and activism, community outreach, you name it. It's just a really, really beautiful program. Again, that's very near and dear to my heart. I have another video. This is from one of our satellite programs, and our satellite programs are condensed versions of our camps that we do on different Bahamian islands. So our main camp happens on the island of Eleuthera, but this satellite program is on the island of Cat Island. So I'll share this with you.
Today we are going to be dissecting the stomach of this fish.
So that's just a small snippet. So in our programs, our students, they are out in the middle of the ocean trawling for microplastics. They're dissecting the stomachs of birds like albatross boluses they're inspecting. They're dissecting stomachs of fish like mahi-mahi, wahoo, tuna, and they're seeing the firsthand impacts of how their lifestyle on land actually impacts animals, especially those that we rely on as a food source in the Bahamas. So just this hands-on approach, the students are really transformed and they're all in. And it's just the most beautiful experience. So we have students from as young as 5 years old, all the way up to 16, 17 years old that engage in our programs. And it's not just them coming and we're talking about plastic. There's actually a science to this. And I've quantified this science through what you see here. And this is called our plastic warrior feedback loop. So we call our students plastic warriors. And a plastic warrior is basically someone who is on the front lines fighting against marine debris and plastic pollution through grit, through strength, through passion and creativity. You know, the support is unwavering. So our students come into the program through environmental education and that connection to nature, right? Because you protect what you love. If I bombard them with messages of how awful the oceans are doing, you know, it can be really draining. But if we say, listen, let's go to the beach, let's go for a swim. And then after that, let's come out of the water, let's walk along the shoreline, and let's do a visual observation of what we see. Do you see the impacts of the waste that's all around us in this space that we enjoy? So from that connection to nature, we then go into the citizen science, where they're then quantifying what they're seeing, and they're realizing that science is for everyone, and it can be as simple as picking up a piece of plastic and counting it. That's science. From that, we then go into community action, where it's localized action and engagement. And this can look like different projects. For example, in 2017, we had our straw-free island project where we partnered with the Last Plastic Straw organization and Jackie Nunez, who is from Santa Cruz. She might be on this call. So big up to you, Jackie, if you're on the call. So for that project, we went into the community and we engaged businesses and restaurants to take a pledge to say, you know, we're not going to give out straws only on request, or we're going to switch to a more eco-friendly alternative. From there, we go into public education and knowledge sharing. At the end of the program, the students, they put on a community outreach event where they invite the community and they share their knowledge by using Bahamian skits and dances. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. That then goes into public policy and engaging lawmakers, which I'll elaborate on further. And then it comes back with the youth leadership and peer mentoring. All of the students who come through our program, they come back as camp counselors, right? So that circle and that cycle continues. And this is all rooted in the core values of stewardship, empowerment, creativity, leadership, and activism. I mentioned the scientific research earlier where they're, you know, dissecting boluses and quantifying plastic that they see that's ingested. They're counting the microplastics at the sea surface in Bahamian waters. They're doing fun media projects. This was our Ocean Friendly Lifestyle series. This was one of my favorites where they were showing the audience all around the world, you know, this is how you can make your own toothpaste or your own body scrub to reduce using single-use plastics. Art activism, a lot of the plastic that we collect from the beach, unfortunately, it goes to the landfill. The majority goes there, but we reclaim some of that and we make murals that the students have full advantage over. You know, many years I'm like, y'all, we should do this. And they're like, Miss Kristal, step back, we got this. So you can see this mural on the left. This was the Wave of Change, and that's at the Rock Sound International Airport on Eleuthera. And then we have Daisy Dolphin, and she's, you know, telling people to stop trashing our treasures. And she lives at the Tarpon Bay Clinic in South Eleuthera. For our community outreach, this is all youth-led as well. We have trash and fashion shows. Our students use Bahamian culture to create songs, skits, musical numbers, all about plastic pollution, education, and awareness. We have a lot of upcycling projects you can see in the upper left-hand corner. We reclaimed or we diverted a bunch of plastic bottles from going to the landfill and we made bins and we put them in the community. And this is a trash and fashion show. It's Capri Sun shorts and a handbag. And this was all led by our students who were 13 and 14 and they were teaching each other how to make these fashion designs and also how to make jewelry from plastic. And again, bringing it back to youth, in 2017, 80% of our staff were between the ages of 12 and 16 years old. And about 50% of them were former students, right? So we really hammer home the message that youth are the change and they can drive things forward. Because I really believe that they are powerful and effective leaders. They're full of ideas, they're excited, they're socially connected between the TikToks and the Snapchats and all these things. And when youth speak, the world listens, and that's because youth are the change. And I'm just going to show you this video and I'll elaborate on it a little bit more. Well, I'll switch that up, sorry. So in being that youth are the change, not putting so much on their shoulders that they have to solve problems, but that we have to partner together to solve these problems. And one of these issues that arose was how do we get the Bahamas to ban single-use plastics? And this is what the students came up with.
Minister, I'm a plastic warrior with the Bahamas Plastic Movement, and we need your help to find a solution to plastic pollution. Scientists say by the year of 2050, there may be more plastic in the oceans than fish. One solution is we can ban the use of plastic bags in the Bahamas, but we need your help.
Dear Minister of Health, the fish are eating the polluted toxic plastic in the sea, and we are eating that plastic on fish too. We need your help.
Dear Minister of Environmental Health, we collected over 2,000 pieces of plastic bags, straws, bottles, and styrofoam in under 45 minutes. We need your help.
Dear Ministry of Education, we are involved with plastic pollution education, ocean conservation, summer camp. We have learned about harmful impact of plastic in our ocean. We need to share this to the youth and community of the Bahamas. We need your help. Prime Minister,
Cabinet Ministers, people of the Bahamas, we need your help. We need to take a stand and ban plastic bags in the Bahamas. Us kids are only 25% of the population, but 100% of the future. We are the solution to plastic pollution.
Ban plastic bags. It's time to take a stand.
So for that project, I was thinking really one-sided. I was like, oh, maybe we should write a letter to one specific minister. And the students were like, Miss Kristal, but what about education? What about health? I was like, you're right. And they brought a whole laundry list of all the cabinet ministers for the Bahamas, and they selected who we needed to address. And it kind of started there, but I knew that we needed more than just the video. How do we really engage government in this crucial topic? So following our camp in 2017, I hosted a youth activism workshop where I got the top leaders from our camp together and we brainstormed for 3 days. We worked with a social scientist who taught us all about social science and how do we gauge attitudes and perceptions of locals. So she taught the students how to create surveys, and they went out and they did questionnaires to see if people would actually support the ban, and a lot of people were for it. We brought in a local lawyer and she taught us all about how legislation and policy worked in the Bahamas. And with her help, we were able to draft a bill for what a plastic bag tax would look like for the Bahamas, because we wanted to get low-hanging fruit before we went all out. So once we got that bill drafted, we got confirmation that the minister would see us. Me and this crew of warriors, we flew from the island of Eleuthera to Nassau to meet with the minister. Now, when we went there, I was like, guys, we got to be formal. You know, if you got a church suit or a blazer, make sure you wear it. And we got to be professional. And they were like, Miss Kristal, that's boring. We got to go in there. We got to make noise. We got to be live. And that's exactly what we did. We went in there beating on the desk saying, we are the change. We're the solution. We can fix this plastic pollution. And it got the minister's attention. And we were able to lay out all of our deliverables that we wanted. And we went there in January of 2018, and we said that by Earth Day, or by the end of the first quarter, which would have been March 2018, we wanted him to push our bill through the House of Assembly. And on Earth Day 2018, which was April 22nd, they had a national press conference announcing that the Bahamas was banning single-use plastics. And that was all pushed forward by youth from our organization. So as of January 1st, 2020, these four items are forbidden in the country. For use and importation, along with mass balloon releases, which was also suggested by our organization. But you know, just to wrap up, it's not so simple. You know, this work is really fun because it's led with heart and it's led with joy. But there's a lot of despair when we talk about plastic pollution and social justice issues, environmental issues that face the world, our oceans, people of color. There's a fine line between depression and inspiration, I always like to say, but I stay on the side of hope, and I get my hope and my inspiration from these young warriors, from these people. So I want you to know that there is hope. So hold on to hope and keep going. Thank you so much for joining. I think I went way over time. I am so sorry. But if you want to learn more about our organization, please follow us on all social media platforms at Bahamas Plastic Movement. Check out our YouTube videos if you want to see more content. And follow me, Kristal Ocean Speaks on Instagram. I'm trying a thing. So I'm trying to get my followers up there. So you can follow me there. Thanks, everyone.
Wow, thank you. Thank you so much, Kristal. That is just a total treat to listen to, you know, having followed your work for a while and seeing its progress and just seeing the impact really that it's having transnationally is just, you know, it's just so great to see. And, you know, I see questions that have come already through the chat, but I wanted to start with just a, you know, there's so much to bring up. This is just bringing up so much with me, but you brought up this, the core sort of stewardship, the values, and this sort of circular arrangement of how the politicization of this, of the camp, you know, the camp participants to become community stewards, to become environmental stewards, policy advocates, and then come back and shape community again. And it seems like you're taking a model and circularizing it in a way that can also be informing how we relate to land and how we relate to, you know, the disposable linear economy. And it just is so, I think it's very, you know, inspiring. And, you know, you brought up that, you know, this, you know, you don't want to focus too much on plastic itself. You know, it's about solutions, it's about hope. And I, you know, it resonates with me in my own experience of just, you know, I came in with marine bio background, ecology, and then, you know, before you know it, you're like studying this stuff doesn't actually, you know, we're seeing the detriments upstream through our consumer, you know, behavior. And it kind of like funnels us into, you know, away from the things that we think we, you know, we love so much, right? The natural, I used to study salamanders and, you know, turtles, and I've been with sharks. And so the question I have for you is that, you know, oftentimes this question about plastic gets reduced to like the literal plastic, you know, with little attention to the systems through which it arises, mm-hmm. and how it's unevenly deposited. And how do you see anti-plastic activism in your community shaping relationships beyond plastic itself, right? And you're seeing how these, you know, it's building, you know, it's through arts and through culture and through song and dance. And it's just so much there that plastic has been used to be able to bring us together, even despite this sort of dismal fate. So I'm just curious to hear your thoughts on that.
That's a really great question and a great point that you bring up. But you're right, right? Like it's a gathering point. Like if it wasn't for plastic, this work wouldn't be taking place. But even when we talk about plastic, we put the onus on the consumer, on the people, on the youth. And so often I would say to the students, we've made a mess and you have to fix it. You know, and through my unlearning and relearning and growing, I realized that that's not fair, that they didn't create this problem. So how dare I, along with the rest of society, put this pressure on them to find solutions. But when I think about the work I see and how it impacts community, I see it as reclamation almost, reclamation of our natural spaces, of our voices, of us taking back our power to maintain and the cleanliness of our own ecosystems for our own well-being, not just for tourism purposes, you know? And that's what it's getting the students to connect to, because when you ask, why should we keep our beaches clean? Any child, anywhere, any age, the first thing they're gonna say is, so that the tourists can come back, you know? And yes, that is true to an extent, but what about for you? We live here, you know, year round. These are our sacred spaces also. And we deserve to have clean places that we can thrive in, that can benefit, that the ocean benefits from, and we will in turn. So that's how I see it, as a reclamation, not only of sacred spaces, but also sacred practices, because we were zero waste at one time, you know, the indigenous people of the Bahamas, my grandparents' generation and the generations before those. So that's a thing. So it's just like realigning in a sense. So that's how I see it.
Thank you, Kristal. And I think that really sets me up for my question. I kind of told you a couple weeks ago that I was going to ask this, but, you know, it is really sacred work that you're doing to be working to clean the oceans generations to come, and really working across youth, and not just youth, but working across generations to really hone in on this idea that we can protect what's sacred to us year round. And so I just want you to share a little bit about following that calling, and how do you maintain, you know, that knowing, and what ways are you trying to get the kids to see that every day?
I think getting them to see every day starts with the investment itself, right? And one thing that I try to hammer into the students is their ability to be change makers. So we have this chant, hey, change maker, I'm a change maker, youth are the change, that it's a call and response that we do back and forth. So getting them to realize that they can do anything and that they can overcome their fears. A big part of my work too is connecting students, young people to the ocean, and getting them to break past their fears, to understand that if you can swim in 5 feet of water, you can swim in 5,000. It's all mental, right? So using the ocean
as a source to break your own barriers of what you're afraid of, and then transitioning that new strength to be applied to the work. So I think that's where it's invested in the self, being the student, and their capability to face any task, starting with something as scary as the ocean, and then bringing that right back to land to act.
That's beautiful. Thank you. Yeah, I think starting with that, with what makes us feel alive, can help us get through a lot of this mucky work. You know, we wanted to bring this up. You know, you brought up the connection of your family that lived next to the landfill in Nassau. You also brought up, you know, Hurricane Dorian and its impacts, and sort of this relationship between plastic justice and climate justice. You know, I've lived in the South. I think there's several people on this call actually who I've invited in from past organizing work, and thinking through sort of the relationship between sort of racial waste, these geographies of pollution that's, you know, oftentimes find themselves in communities of color, and also in Black communities, and, you know, in Island Nation communities and the Gulf South communities. And I was curious, you know, if you could just like speak to this question of like disposability and the Bahamas, and thinking through sort of how do we reframe this, how do we reframe this, you know, pattern that seems to be going from the extraction, you know, all the way to where this oil is being taken out of, you know, oftentimes out of the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico, and then refined in oftentimes these Black communities, and then polluting right back through, you know, the island nations, also in the beaches, but also through the landfill in this proximity. It feels like it makes the case for, we just have to eliminate waste altogether. How have you been able to, you know, use plastic to think through sort of this whole system in your own research as well, this massive system that's very racially charged as well?
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a really great question. And I feel like as I'm growing in this work too, like these are things that need to be addressed. My connection to plastic and marine debris was from my love of the ocean and my background in marine science and seeing that as an issue, right? So I always tackled it or saw it from the perspective of, oh, you know, we have to save the marine life and, you know, human health, thinking about how plastic moves its way up the food chain, but not looking at the upstream impacts and how, whenever we use plastic from its production, from its extraction, production, use to disposal, it's an issue at every aspect of its life. And when we think about the production, the extraction of the oil, the greenhouse gas emissions that come out of that mass production, that then intensifies climate issues. And we, you know, we get those impacts through the increase or intensified storms that we're seeing all around the world, throughout the Caribbean. We receive that, but we still perpetuate these systems because of our lack of sovereignty, lack of food sovereignty, right? So we're so dependent on food and other items that we import into the country that creates a lot of waste. Our waste sovereignty, because we're not recovering any of this waste and using it in a way that benefits the island, whether that's recapturing food waste, creating compost so that we can grow our own food, because that is not happening at a large enough scale right now in the country, or whether that's recovering plastic materials that can be recycled and reused to create a closed loop system. I think I lost a little bit of your question a little bit. So that's where my work is. It's now intersecting, right? Is like trying to understand what is the way forward. Because even I talk about plastic pollution and marine debris and all of the plastic that's washing ashore, but then what? You know, and then what? We pick it up, we do a cleanup, we post it on the gram, it gets a few likes, but I still have this internal struggle because we drop it off by the landfill, it's getting burned, it's still, you know, that cycle is perpetuating. So now it's like, how do I understand what are the proper management strategies to deal with the issue locally,
but also still have a tie to the global conversation of production and how that drives climate and disenfranchises people in small island communities. I hope that answered the question.
It did really, thank you. We have so many questions coming in. I'd like to give people a chance to be able to get some of their questions asked. One is from an anonymous attendee who's asking, would you be able to tell if the program, the Bahamas Plastic Movement Program, has an environment that embraces young people of Haitian descent?
Sak passe, I'm half Haitian, of course. Yes, my mom is Haitian and my grandmother. I grew up in a Haitian household. My father is Bahamian. Of course, our program is very diverse. We have Bahamian students from all walks of life. It doesn't matter. We all inclusive over here. I don't discriminate. So yes, it is very embracive.
Okay, we're just gonna go down a little bit of this line. Bree, do you wanna go for it?
Yeah. So we have a question from Teresa. It says, thank you for speaking with travelers and tourists engage in the environmental efforts in the Caribbean and other areas. Is there such a thing as ethical tourism?
I think ethical tourism doesn't and can exist. I don't have any examples off the top of my head, but encouraging tourists, you know, it's always like bring your reusables with you, use them wherever you can, but there also needs to be structures in place that support that. So from a political perspective, I would love to see where the Bahamas starts putting in taxes, like green taxes on all tourists that visit the country, so that they pay in advance for the waste that they're going to leave on our shorelines. The same for cruise ships as well, because cruise ships leave their waste in our country at no cost, that we have to deal with and manage. So I think those are some examples, like paying a green tax, refusing single-use plastics where you can, but then sometimes that's not as simple, depending on where they're visiting, so.
That makes sense. We're gonna transition to this question from Kiamber, which says, hi, Kristal. I direct a youth environmental education org in Texas, so it's dope to see other examples of enviro ed orgs for youth. Are your programs age specific, or do all of our programs include youth across all ages? If your programs are inclusive of all ages of youth, what have been some of the advantages and challenges?
Yes, we're inclusive of all ages in our main plastic program. We have students as young as 5 years old. And so often I go back and forth, I'm like, oh, are they too young? But they're not, because they absorb everything and they get so passionate. And how we manage that in our program is we have them in different groups. So we have the sea turtles, and that's your 5 to 7 year olds. And we have the mahi-mahi, they're older, and you kind of get the picture. The only disadvantage of that is when you want to get into hard hitting topics, it kind of goes over the head of the younger students. So sometimes we have other programs where it's geared towards older students, or our Ocean Ambassadors program, that's for our older students. And another program we'll be working on this summer, that'll be for older students. So we have workshop models, we have full camps where everyone is involved, and then we have the satellite programs that can be targeted towards any age.
Thank you. So we have one that's going a little bit more into the plastic from Flora. So we say, recent media coverage has highlighted that a handful of companies like ExxonMobil and Dow Medical produce the majority of plastic, and that they are incentivized to keep producing more rather than finding ways to recycle or reduce. So how can we address corporate corruption and connections to their proliferation of plastics?
I know recently a lot of organizations like Plastic Pollution Coalition, Algalita, Break Free from Plastic, they've been pushing for the Break Free from Plastic Act, which would actually hold producers responsible and kind of put, I guess,
And maybe Jackie, I see you on the call. Thank you for your comment. Maybe you can comment in the chat more about how that particular act will work. But I think there needs to be more political incentives to hold these companies accountable because there are a lot of ties, man. Like, plastic money runs deep and that goes to oil and gas. Like, it's a mafia, you know? So we really, really need to have clear systems in place that are honest and that hold these companies accountable.
Yeah, there was just a news article that showed all of the financial institutions that are backing, you know, all of these petrochemical institutions, and it's like, you know, millions, billions of dollars. So it's, yeah, like you just mentioned, it goes super deep.
Yeah.
We're trying to go through some of these later questions. Sammy is asking, in the early years of your movement or organization, did you encounter pushback from the community, or was it fairly easy to introduce and engage the community with your work and movement?
Yes, there's always pushback. So I'll take it a step back. The reason why Bahamas Plastic Movement really came to fruition, I was working at an organization and I was a minority there. It was a US-based organization in the Bahamas. And, you know, I was pushing like, oh, we should have more research and let's expand this work. And I was told it's not new research. You know, no one really cares about that. It only belongs in this space. And because of that, I was like, man, I gotta reach my people. And that's when I took the bold step and started this organization with no blueprint. But within the community itself, of course, there's always pushback, people don't necessarily understand what you're doing. And that's why the work is focused so much on working with youth, because they get it and then they go home and they infiltrate their households and they tell their parents what they've learned and why they can't use plastic bags or plastic straws. And then they hold their families accountable. So it's like working from the inside out, basically. So those are some of the challenges. And then also one challenge has been this idea that if you use a reusable bag or if you're into the environment or environmental protection, you know, you've been hanging around white people for too long. Like, that's not for us, you know, us being the majority. So that's been one cultural construct that's been kind of challenging, but it's changing for sure.
Hey, thank you. And our next question, it says, thank you for sharing this great work that you and the youth have been doing in the Bahamian Islands. Spirit says they've gathered that the tourists are a major contributor to the plastic problem as much as they bring in for revenue. So what steps, if any, are being considered to make them participate in the cleanup and zero waste movement?
I know, for example, at the Atlantis Resort, which is the largest hotel in the Bahamas, they have now gone plastic free. So all of their guests, they get a reusable water bottle, and there are refillable stations around the facility, around the property, where people can refill their bottles. So that's one example. I think there might be cleanup events. A lot of people message me and they're like, how can we get involved? So there's no program that's set up in place right now where people can go and, you know, participate in a beach cleanup. But the option is available if they reach out and do it independently. As far as it relates to zero waste, that's the only example at a large scale. I don't see anything else being done just yet.
Thanks. Okay, we have two more questions in here. I'll take the one from Angela. Hey, Professor Alan Bell, thanks for joining us today. And she asks, what solutions are you advocating insofar as prevention of waste like this, no plastic use? What sort of solutions?
So for our messaging, I try to be very clear and realistic. You know, we live on an island. We're an island nation. We're heavily reliant on the importation of goods for us to survive. So telling people to avoid all types of plastic, it's not necessarily realistic. But what we focus on are the single-use materials. That's our messaging, these things that we use for such a short period of time, and they easily end up in the environment. So providing people with simple solutions that are not super gentrified, that don't cost a lot of money, like open your drawer, take your own fork and spoon with you wherever you go. If you have a old pasta jar, take that with you and make that your water bottle. So it's just trying to highlight getting back to that reuse culture that we did have within our islands until we can really get systems in place to manage the plastic that's being consumed in the country.
Thank you. And given that you're trying to practice these sort of more reusable habits in your everyday life, we have another question that says, how do you practice being environmentally conscious day to day? And are there specific brands or products you stand behind? Or are you more about reusing things that are in your own home every day? So yeah.
I try to reuse as much as possible. My life has been pretty nomadic, and living in the Bahamas, it's hard to have a zero waste lifestyle. So I am not zero waste. And where I encounter a lot of single use plastic is when I'm buying produce. Now I buy a lot of free produce that's not packaged, but if I'm getting fruit or spinach, like everything here in Europe, I'm based in Sweden doing my PhD, a lot of these things come in plastic, and that's the only thing that's daunting. And then like personal care products that I have, some of those are still in plastic. But I just came across a zero waste store yesterday, and I'm really excited to start that journey because I have all my glass jars ready to go. So I'm going to get into that. But there aren't any products in particular that I stand behind, just ethical brands that don't greenwash and that are actually really committed to being plastic free and zero waste.
Great. And Kiamber wants to follow up in terms of products, asking, have you found a sunscreen that is coral reef safe and blends well with darker skin tones?
That is a great question. And now, it's only taken me 31 years after living in a place with 350 days of sun, I just started wearing sunscreen. It is reef safe, but you got to really blend it all the way in because you'd be looking pasty. So I don't have a recommendation. But if you do, let me know. Oh, actually, I think Fenty Beauty, Rihanna's not sponsoring me, but I did see a video that she posted. One of her products has sunscreen in it that is reef safe. And it's for darker skin tone. So that's something you can look into.
So there's no more questions in here, but I'm really curious about you had mentioned the presentation when you were taking this desire to the Ministry of Environment with all of the youth, the delegation of youth of the Plastic Warriors, and you had kind of said, okay, we have to be professional, we have to look good, and they came back at you with, no, we need to chant, we need a song, we need to really hit them sort of off guard, right? And catch them off guard and catch their attention. And it just kind of reminds me of sort of this X factor that's needed in this movement to capture attention, but also to think in sort of non-normative ways that are outside of the box that the youth might have. I think also just through diversifying sort of zero waste movement in general, I think a lot of people of color can contribute to different like lively ways to kind of think through this question and how it's kind of still strangled by respectability politics and sort of this ways and like, oh, this isn't going to be adaptable or this isn't going to be well received. And really thinking about like, the future of plastics and the sort of the prospects, like you mentioned by 2050, like there's going to be more plastic than fish. And, you know, like, if we don't start to really shake things up, you know, and take this sort of that idea of, you know, not playing necessarily by the rules of the game, you know, if we don't do that, this pattern might still continue. And so I really appreciated that you brought that in and sort of this youth energy to kind of shake it up a little bit.
Yeah, thank you. And you know, it's about trust. And that's the beautiful thing about our partnership with youth. And I say that word partnership because we're all on the same playing field. And even though there are boundaries, it's still too wide seeing, like, what do you think about this problem? How can we work on this together? And it takes trust, like trusting their opinions and seeing how I can guide you forward. I can't tell you how many times students have talked me off the ledge or told me a different way to do something. And I'm like, man, y'all onto something, you know, we should do it this way. So you should acknowledge their voices. It's really powerful. And by acknowledging those voices, you empower them to move forward and break down these systems, because it's really going to be them that's going to be continuing this fight. So I think that's really important.
Thank you. Yeah, I just want to make a quick announcement that we have about 15 more minutes open for folks for comments and questions. So please add them to the Q&A. It's okay. We'll get to them when we get to them. But I also wanted to dig a little bit deeper into what are these plastics, right? So it's kind of hard to know what is what these days. I mean, I think each state has their own types of recycling methods. So even the types of waste that we produce and thinking we're recycling, you know, doesn't always help. So as someone who works with marine debris and these plastics sort of on the regular, what advice can you give us lay people for recognizing these plastics and what types of plastics we're actually dealing with in the ocean, micro versus macro? What can you share a little bit more about that?
Sure. So a lot of plastics that we are seeing, especially on beaches in the Bahamas, it's usually legacy plastics. So these are plastics that date back to the 1950s or as far back as the 1950s, even towards recent times as well. They've been degraded into the environment. So they're usually PET, which is polyethylene. That's usually your number ones. Right, your number ones. Oh, you have HDPE, LDPE, I feel like. Yeah, low density polyethylene, that's right. So these are what you're seeing. These are your water bottles, your milk jugs, your containers that your fabric softeners come in. We see a lot of those washing up on the beaches, but those are also the plastics that are easily recoverable and that can be recycled. But then you have the plastic, like the films, that are usually that low density polyethylene, your chip bags, your plastic bags, those that don't have any value once they've been discarded. And those are the ones that you find more frequently in the environment as well. For example, in the Bahamas, Atlantic Ocean sites, which are windward facing beaches that face the open ocean. This is where we find the weathered plastic, the degraded plastic, the microplastics and fragments, a lot of fishing gear, like octopus pots that wash ashore from the west coast of Africa and onto coastlines in the Bahamas and in the Caribbean. We see them on that coast. But then the leeward coast, which is where most locals will go to party or play, that's where you see your anthropogenic trash, so your beer bottles and cans and your plastic bags, chip bags and stuff like that, styrofoam containers. So you do see the geography of the debris, it changes. But yeah, that's mostly what we discover.
Thanks for that. Yeah, it's hard to keep track of all the numbers and the polystyrene, polyethylene. So we have a question from Karen Crespo Treveño, who also does a lot of youth organizing work, particularly around, you know, petrochemicals and agriculture here in the Salinas Valley with youth. She says, thank you so much for this amazing presentation conversation. I'm deeply inspired by you. And I'm wondering, how do you personally manage feelings of burnout, and how do you teach your youth to manage stress and their mental health as they're participating in your programs?
Oh, that's a great question. I was actually just messaging one of my students earlier tonight, talking about mental health. And it's okay to take a break and pause and share your feelings and put space. And that's the same thing that I'm telling her is what I'm learning. The burnout is real. You know, and if I have to be honest, I don't enjoy talking about the ills of plastic as much as I enjoy talking about the joy of working towards solutions. I find that, you know, all of a sudden everyone's looking for me to have the answers, you know, oh, you're the expert, which I'm like, no, I'm not, you know, so it can get overwhelming in that sense. And also having this fisheye lens on you and trying to conform to what I think people think that I should be doing with the work and how it should function. And, you know, it's so easy to take on that stress, but I take a step back and I breathe and I have to remember, you know, why, remember the why, and why I started and what is pushing me along this journey, and just take some space and go slow. You know, in this PhD now, so basically how the organization has functioned, it's always been on and off. I've always had one foot in, one foot out, because I've been a student for the last like 7 or 8 years. And I'd be going back and forth to the Bahamas. And I always feel like I have to be doing the most, like while I'm here trying to do this PhD, which is a mental cycle in its own right. I'm like, oh, I have to be doing this for the organization and this and this and this, not realizing that the work feeds into itself and I need to just let things flow. So I meditate a lot. I go out into nature. You know, I go by the water when I need some time to breathe and think. And then, yeah, we just have check-ins with the kids. Mm-hmm. How does this make you feel? What's going on in your life? And through my connection with the students, you know, it's not just me teaching them about plastic. I've had so much meaningful conversations and learning about the trauma that they go through and what their households are like and how coming to camp and being a part of the programs, it's an outlet for them. And that keeps me going too. And it helps me to realize that this work is not about me, but it's about facilitation for them. So yeah, that's where I am. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Angela.
Yeah. Yeah, there's just this balance between like the heart-based, you know, passion, and then sort of having to, even like you're in, all the way in Sweden, you know, having to do intellectual work, but you know, there's so much like you're trying to get back home.
Right.
And yeah, it's just, it pulls you in so many directions to just fighting this burnout. I don't know, Brie, if you have a question, I could ask questions all day, but I don't want to steal the mic.
No, I think this question of, you know, anticipating the burnout and encouraging people to take space is really encouraging to hear, as we often think about environmental justice as work that is sustainable. So thinking about how we sustain ourselves, I think, is really useful. But another question that I have actually digs a little bit more into something you mentioned earlier in your presentation about perceptions of environmental justice and it being about a proximity to whiteness. And for you, about reclaiming those sort of cultural, ancestral ways of recycling, reusing as ways of like enacting sovereignty. So I just really want you to elaborate a little bit more on that and really share like what it is about sort of these legacies of colonialism that we can really disrupt when we pay attention to these solutions and to the way we already live, but that sometimes gets lost in, you know, the other things we do.
Yeah, that's a really great question. In the Bahamas, for example, we are so close to America. They say if America sneezes, we catch it, it's cold because we're so close. So we have all these Western influences and access to these means of conveniences that kind of draw us away from our culture. And we see our relationship to waste as less than, right? Someone who, a garbage man is less than by societal standards. People justify littering because someone needs the job to clean it up. People justify not picking up waste because it's not my job. I don't touch garbage, you know, stuff like that. But if we were able to revision our perception of waste as a resource and see how it benefits us as a nation and as a people, and how it has done that in the past, I think that'll help shape our way forward. And I'm just really inspired by what's happening on the ground right now in the Bahamas. There's so many young millennials doing things that, like my friend Dorlin, he has vermicomposting where he's using worms to create soil and break down compost and planting things. We worked together last summer with the students with these mealworms to see if they can actually eat styrofoam, and they do. So we've been looking at how can we now incorporate this into waste management, right? So there's like so many different approaches, but I think changing our perception of our relationship to waste is where we need to start.
Yeah, I mean, waste is, you know, it is, it's, things are so valuable until all of a sudden what's inside them gets consumed, and then all of a sudden it's worthless. And, you know, oil is ancestrally millennia in terms of its age, right? This oil that's been taken out and then disposed of so nonchalantly seems like we have a lot of that sort of, you know, deep work to do to kind of rethink about waste and those impacts, and how we can kind of reclaim it or refuse it. One question I have is sort of this flashpoint of COVID and also plastic. And given that it's so transnational, you know, it obviously the impacts are uneven, but they're also like global in terms of, you know, the contributions and that, you know, everyone can kind of talk about plastic and waste in a way, whether as a consumer, as a buyer, as someone who's, you know, on the sort of detrimental end of it. And I'm curious, like through this work that you've been doing, what sort of like unlikely collaborations have spurred up, either transnationally or people who you wouldn't have necessarily expected, because it's like, oh wow, like we're so connected even just through this conversation about waste, and I didn't learn about this, you know, this island community, or, you know, how you guys are fighting it. And, you know, I see the model of the youth of the of Bahamas, you know, advocating for policy change being so inspiring for, you know, radiating out, you know, hopefully for, you know, as a signpost for so many other youth to kind of take on and advocate our own, you know, politicians. And so just curious, like, how have you seen convergences, unlikely convergences, play out in your work?
Unlikely, when you say unlikely, do you mean that's not in relation to plastic or still?
Maybe they could be in relation, or, you know, we're thinking about some of the youth here who wouldn't identify as Bahamian, but it's still, you know, there's like, do you see any youth who've been like, wait, we want to join y'all, like from a different country, have they reached out to y'all and been like, yo, we need to work together and like tackle this internationally across these divisions that are, you know, these that aren't serving anyone really, besides these power structures to keep us inefficiently organizing against them?
Yes, there's a group from India, and they're interested in doing a joint virtual program between our students and theirs, because the connections of waste and what we both experience, even though we're on different continents, it's eerily similar. So she just sent me a draft program. I need to go and look through that. So there's opportunity for collaboration there. That's the one that comes to mind. But then the opportunity for us to take our student, man, that's not the only one. The opportunity for us to take our students every summer, not every summer, every spring, we go to the Alga Leader Plastic Ocean Pollution Solutions International Youth Summit. And it's all about plastic pollution. So for 7 years, we've been taking students there, and we connect with people from all around the world. And the most fruitful connection there was with people from Hawaii who ended up coming to the Bahamas, and we worked together on a joint program, a filmmaking program where we communicated issues about plastic through film. So that was really cool. And then also, you know, working with Plastic Pollution Coalition and Jackie Nunez and Alga Leader, and getting them to come to the Bahamas and participate in our plastic camp, and help facilitate some of that work as well. So there's been all sorts of cross-pollinations, and just outside of that, you know, me being able to travel places like Norway, Kenya, here in Sweden, all around the States, just to talk about this work and connect with others. So it's been really fruitful.
Wow. Well, we, you know, we're so honored with, you know, you being here. Even digitally, we wish you could have been here in person for sure. But, you know, the goal of this is really to kind of keep building this relationship, because I know there's several people on this call who do youth organizing, who would love to kind of tap in and try to figure out how to think across, you know, these superficial differences, you know, with this common sort of, it's this common problem. You know, Teresa, who asked the question earlier, works with youth and travel. And so there's, you know, I think there's a lot of convergences here that we'd love to keep alive.
I think so too. And I just want to extend my thanks and my undying gratitude for everyone for, you know, taking the time to join this call. And I just want to highlight Chris because he mentioned circularity and full circle. When I started Bahamas Plastic Movement years ago, you know, Chris was one of the first persons to reach out to me and offer his support and, you know, his willingness to come down and volunteer and just be involved. And you believed in everything that we did. So thank you so much, Chris, for your faith, for sowing those seeds, and also for this platform. And Breanna, you as well, and all organizers that are involved, I really appreciate it. So thank you so much. If you want to learn more about our work, Bahamas Plastic Movement on all social media networks, and Kristal Ocean Speaks if you want to stay in touch with me. And just a plug from Jackie here. Did I see something? Oh, Plastic Pollution Coalition's next webinar is June 23rd. Poisoned Planet, the Injustice of Disposable Culture, of Hope for the Future. So you can check the chat for more information on that.
Great, thanks so much for bringing that, Jackie.
And just to conclude, thank you all so much for joining us today. We wish we could be out here the rest of the evening, Shadow, but we know Kristal has to go to sleep, y'all. So
I'm wide awake now.
But we'd like to mention this event was made possible through the Measure 15 Student Fund Initiative. We also like to let everyone know on the call of this event happening on Saturday, highlighting the experiences of college youth from the Amamutsin Tribal Band. So to register for that, please use the registration link that we're going to post in the chat. And lastly, both the ARC and PoCSC teams will greatly appreciate any feedback. Thank you all so much. And we hope to see y'all soon.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Chris. Thanks, Bree. Thanks, ARC. Thanks, POCSC. All the S's and C's.
We're gonna have to make a chant out of that one. That's it. You got all these brilliant youth about to make little chants and songs out of this. That's what we're gonna do.
We have to. Bring the drums.
Yeah. Oh, we're gonna ring it off. No, it's been long overdue to get us all together. And if any Bahamian youth want to come over here to Cali, we'll definitely be able to host.
We love California. I would love to. We'll make that happen post-COVID.
Certainly. Well, thank you, everybody, again.
Thanks, everyone. Have a good evening. Bye.
Oh, bye, Augie. Thanks, Mitch. Thanks, Chris. Tashina. Awesome. Okay, well, thank you, Gen Z, Mel, and Rihanna. I'm going to stop recording now.